Good morning and welcome to the August 30th Tapestry Worship Gathering, the day in which we find out how effective the windscreen on this microphone truly is. I hope you've had a good week. If you have not had a good week, I hope something about what you see today from your brothers and sisters in Christ will help lift you up and remind you of a God who loves you very much. Please remember to reach out to one another. That is the most important thing right now. We need to reach out to one another. Wow, we're really going to find out right now. I'm about to be hit by a limb. We're going to find out right now if we do a decent job of conveying to one another the hope that is in Christ. So please reach out to one another. Only announcements we have right now is one, as I mentioned last week, we have a nominee for leadership team because Pete is rotating off and Heidi Holte is that nominee. This is the second week's notice, so we are trying to do this as legal as possible, but we don't have any guidelines in how to hold a leadership team vote during a pandemic. And so therefore, what the leadership team came up with was 2 weeks announcement, and then we will do an email vote. The email vote will be active this next Sunday for the following week. And I'm going to post that email below in the description today, but your votes don't start until next week. So please consider that. Again, it's Heidi Holte is the nominee, and the vote here is yes or no. Yes, I want her to be on the leadership team, or no, I don't think she should be on the leadership team. So please consider that. And otherwise, you're welcome to watch the worship gatherings at Pam and I's house. You can come over and we will sit outside and watch the TV that we have outside. And if you want to bring coffee and if you want to bring donuts, I'll be thrilled. But otherwise, we would just be honored with your presence. With that said, Kathy Hand is going to begin us with prayer today.
O God, author of and Prince of Peace, whose image each of us bear, listen to our cry in the midst of violence and conflict we see in every corner of our delicate earth. Give us peace by your grace, the peace which your Son Jesus Christ told us, a truth which we experience in the chaos of our own lives is a peace which the world cannot give. To our leaders, grant the wisdom to see beyond the boundaries of race, religion, nation, and selfish interest to the common humanity and image that all of us bear and respond to that image. To those who have taken up arms in anger, revenge, or even the call of justice, grant the grace of a desire and the ability to de-escalate rather than escalate the violence of this world. To the innocents who live in the shadow of terror and hate, especially the frightened children, be a shelter, strength, anchor, and hope. And to those who already lost their lives as victims of cruelty, and to those who love them, open wide your arms of solace and enfold them. Be their comforter and our Prince of Peace. Give us this peace that we may know of your care and your life, and that our worship in the midst of this turmoil may proclaim how worthy you are, because we live in your will, that the peace of heaven may be experienced on earth. We ask all of this in the name of the one who promised us peace, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Today we're going to talk about My Jesus, I Love Thee. It was a hymn written by William Ralph Featherstone in 1862. There's not a whole lot known about the author, and a lot, like a lot of the hymns that we've talked about in the past, it's got this really winding trajectory that involves different iterations of the song, and I always am amazed by that and find it really cool. He was born and raised in Montreal, Canada, and wrote the song at the time of his conversion, so he was like 16 years old. Very young to write such a rich song, in my opinion. It's kind of hard to believe a 16-year-old writing this song. Anyway, he wrote the song, sent it to his aunt in Los Angeles at the time. It was just a poem, I guess, at that point. Sent it to her in Los Angeles. She sent it to friends in England, where it was published anonymously in the London Hymn Book a couple of years later to a now forgotten tune. In 1870, it was given a new tune entirely by a preacher who was putting together a hymnal. It was the service of song for Baptist churches, and he was, I think, in Boston. So it made it from Montreal to England, then back to Boston, and that was a few years later, I think 10 years later. So he was unhappy with the existing tune and wrote a new melody. And he remembered that as, I think he said, in a moment of inspiration, a beautiful new air sang itself into me. It's kind of easy to see how he could be really excited about this tune, as it's really powerful. I find it to be a really interesting tune. It was originally published anonymously, and it wasn't until 1930, so almost 50 years later, before Featherstone was actually given any credit for his part in writing the song. It wasn't credited the first time that it was published. It subsequently wasn't credited to him the second time, so it wasn't until 1930 that, well after it had been published in the Baptist hymnal, that he was given any credit. So that was already 47 years after his death. So he died at the age of 27 in 1873, and of unknown causes. That was presumably the only work that he had as far as poem writing is concerned, or hymn writing. So he was a one-hit wonder, but his legacy still carries on today. So I didn't know this song before this week. I'd heard it before, but I wasn't really familiar with it. I'd never actually sung it or played it myself, and learned it from my grandmother's funeral. I talked to my dad about it last night, actually, and he was talking about how there was a really rich history in our family of having sung that song. I believe he said at his grandmother's, my grandmother's grandmother's funeral, they had sung this song, and it has been subsequently sung at most of the funerals in that family, or all of them that he knew of. So a lot of funerals. It's a really interesting song. In some of the versions I had heard, it omitted that third verse where it talks about wiping the death dew from my brow. So finding that verse was kind of a struggle. It was kind of hard to get through them. Not right now. I'm recording something. You gotta give me a little time, and I can get you some water in a minute. Okay. Sorry. Anyway, finding that verse was really, it was hard to get through. It was really impactful and really, really cool to work through that song this week. So, anyway, that's what I know about it. I got to sing it with my cousins at the funeral, and it was really neat. All right, bye.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. Jesus, Redeemer, my Savior, art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing thy thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lettest me breath, and say when the death do lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown upon my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
Psalm 119, 105 through 112. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. I have taken an oath and confirmed it that I will follow your righteous laws. I have suffered much. Preserve my life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept, O Lord, the willing praise of my mouth, and teach me your laws. Though I constantly take my life in my hands, I will not forget your law. The wicked have set a snare for me, but I have not strayed from your precepts. Your statutes are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. My heart is set on keeping your decrees to the very end.
Hi, everyone. Pastor Robert asked me to read Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and 19 through 29. So here we go. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Open for me the gates of the righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteousness may enter. I will give you thanks, for you have answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
Amen. trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. And Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. And every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, a cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord. Come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone. Faultless we stand before the throne. Faultless we stand before the throne. Faultless we stand before the throne. And Christ alone, a cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
We are in the 8th chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans today. If you have your Bibles near you or have them with you, please look up Romans 8, 1 through 16. If not, please listen to me. This is what the Word of the Lord says. And by the way, this could be a very interesting read because of the wind. I may have should have recorded this on the inside today, but I like recording it outside. So this is what the Word of the Lord says. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit, who gives life, has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so, He condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled, might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you have put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that if we are God's children, that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in His sufferings, in order that we might also share in His glory. Now, guys, up until probably a year and a half ago, I went once a week to Pittsville, Wisconsin. It was a part of my chaplaining gig. As many of you guys know, I am a chaplain on the side, and I chaplain for some businesses. And I would go to Pittsville once a week and visit there. Now, if you've never heard of Pittsville, Wisconsin, you're not alone there, okay? It's got less than 900 people that live in the city limits. There is one gas station. There are three restaurants if you are expanding the city limits a little bit. There's not a lot going on there, but it is, well, it has renown for one thing, and that is that geographically, if this is Wisconsin, it is the geographic center of the state. Officially been proclaimed. Okay, the UW system did research. They figured out this is where it was, and then the Governor Kohler from the 50s, signed an order saying that Pittsville is the geographic center of the state. One of the interesting things on that is the exact spot for the center. There's a plaque. Okay, you can't actually get to the exact spot because the Yellow River goes through the center of Pittsville. And there's a little island there, and that's where the exact geographic spot is. So they have a plaque that I think is about like 250 feet away from that exact spot. And one of my favorite things is what used to be on that island in the 1900s. What was in the center of Wisconsin? Well, it was a tavern. I mean, is there anything more Wisconsin than that? Unless it had been a cheese plant. Guys, your center, it says who you are. And Paul, well, he's at the center of his letter now. And it's really, what is this all about? He starts off with a therefore. This is what he says. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Think about that. There's that word therefore again. And here it really specifically does what we always talk about, which is when you see a therefore, go back and look and see what it's there for. This is the center of the book. Everything Paul has been writing before this has been leading to this point. And everything after this will be influenced by what he says here. And what is at the center of Paul's letter to the Romans? That because of Jesus Christ, there's no condemnation for us anymore. Paul's been talking about how we've all sinned, but now we're at the point where he says there's no condemnation. There's no longer death for us. There's life instead. So we now need to live out that life. So he begins to talk about the new humanity that he's been describing. And the new humanity is a humanity that has been redeemed from its fallenness and now lives out the Spirit. It's the center. Because your center, well, it really defines who you are. There's a movie, an animated movie called The Rise of the Guardians. And it's about basically all of the symbols and figures that are a part of our holidays, how in this movie, they become guardians for the earth. And so, like, Santa Claus is a guardian for the youth, the earth. And the Easter Bunny is a guardian for the earth. And the Tooth Fairy is a guardian. And Jack Frost, this character, he comes up and he's declared a guardian, and he's having to figure out what that means. And there's this one scene where there's a conversation between Santa and Jack Frost, and Santa says, "Jack, what is your center?" He has this discussion of, when you figure out what your center is, it's what influences everything else. And that's what Paul's talking about here. In the center of his letter to the Romans, he's asking the Romans, what is your center? Is your life directed by the realm of the flesh, which leads to destruction? Or is your life directed by the realm of the Spirit, which leads to life? Now, there's an old doodle that used to be used. Many of you may be familiar with this, okay? A lot of different ministries have used it before, where it talks about our lives as a circle, and there's a throne in the center of it. And the question always is, what is in that throne? Because what's in that throne is the center of your life, and it directs everything else. It's how you see everything else. It's how you react to everything else. It's what your priorities are. It determines your actions. And if you know this little doodle, well, so often we take something else. It could be sin. It could be self. It could be good things. And we put them in the center of that circle, on the throne. And when we do, it doesn't even matter if they're good things, okay? They become destructive. Because what was supposed to be in the center of our life is Jesus Christ. When He's in the center of our life and guiding us, it leads to life and puts all the other things in the right order. I mean, think about it. Food. Food is a great thing. It's a wonderful thing. But when food and worry about what we're going to eat is in the center of our lives, it's destructive to us. That's why Jesus says in Matthew 6, He says this, "Do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom, His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you." That doesn't mean that the food and what we drink is a bad thing. It's not. But if our life is governed by our bellies and the consumption thereof, that's destructive. It was never meant to be in the center. Or think about your safety. Being safe is a good thing, okay? It's a good thing for us to be safe. But when our safety is at the center, it becomes destructive. Specifically, it becomes destructive to the way we treat other people quite often. We hoard because all we're worried about is ourselves. We're okay when other people's rights are hurt because all we're worried about is ourselves. When our safety is our core, that's destructive, which is why Jesus says in Matthew 16, He says this, "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it." See, again, that safety is not a bad thing. It's a good thing. It was just never meant to be the central focus of our lives. So, what does this look like when Jesus is actually on the throne of our lives? Well, one of my favorite verses for understanding how life should be lived is Micah 6:8. Matter of fact, if you've been to my house, which most of you have been, you have seen where Pam made these wonderful pillows that sit on an old church pew that we were given that have these three things summarized. And I think it's a great way of knowing what a life centered on Christ looks like. Specifically, the scripture says this, "He has shown you, O mortal, what is good and what does the Lord require of you?" What is our obligation? That's the word Paul uses there. We have an obligation. And if we live in the realm of the flesh, then that obligation is to that, which is destructive. But if we live in the realm of the Spirit, that obligation is to the Spirit, which is life. And what is that obligation? Well, it is this. It is to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. See, when Christ is at the center of our lives, it causes us to view everything else through that. We begin to view, well, our enemy and ourselves and our neighbor as someone who is loved by Christ. And we have to react in love towards them and towards ourselves. We can no longer beat ourselves up saying we're not good enough because we hear Christ say, "You are to me." We love mercy towards ourselves, and we love mercy towards others, and we love mercy towards our enemies, which Paul quotes the Proverbs as saying, when we love our enemies, when we feed our enemies, when we take care of our enemies, we heap burning coals upon their head. Why? Well, because the realm of the flesh is only focused on ourselves, and the realm of the Spirit is focused on Christ and all those who bear His image. It's so different from the rest of the world because the rest of the world is centered on me, myself, and I. Me first, my family first, my tribe first. And Christ is focused on the other. That's what it looks like to have Christ as the center of your life. We love justice and we love mercy. And we walk humbly with our God. And when you walk with someone, you see things the way they see. Every night, Pam and I now walk what we call the bunny walk. It's about a mile loop around our house. And we go out with the sole goal of seeing bunnies and talking with each other, okay? Realistically, it's more about talking with each other than it is that. But we get excited to see bunnies. And when you're looking for bunnies, you see bunnies. When Christ is the center of our lives, He causes us to see things the way He sees them. That's why there's this wonderful quote from C.S. Lewis where he says, "I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but also because I see everything else through it." When Christ is at the center of our lives, we see everything else. The current events that are going on in our lives, our neighbors, our enemies, those we agree with, those we disagree with, God's creation, we see it through His eyes. And we can't respond in selfishness, we have to respond in His love. So how do we live this out? Well, Paul ends this passage with the following verses. He says this, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, 'Abba, Father.' The Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in His sufferings in order that we might also share in His glory." I think of what Paul's saying here as similar to what we have seen. Actually, we saw it at the beginning of this video. I want you to think, if you've ever been to a Tapestry worship gathering, I want you to think for just a second, it's really windy, about the times that you have seen kids lead music in our gatherings. Eric does it every so often with his daughters. Matter of fact, if you noticed at the beginning of the video, Joanna and Eleanor were part of that. And I believe the Holtys have done it with their kids. And I believe that Maria, well, actually, I know she did. In a video, they sang "Jesus Loves Me." And Maria and her kids sang. But think, have you ever seen someone else's kids lead with another person? I haven't, to my memory. And I know for a fact, because I know these people, it's not because if one of those kids asked to lead with them that Eric or the Holtys or Maria would say no, they wouldn't. They would be like, of course, the more the merrier. I mean, Eric set up a drum circle for our kids in the back of one of the worship gatherings one time. He would love it if a kid said, "Hey, can I help you sing?" But the reason it doesn't happen is because the kids never ask. See, when your parent has some authority, even in a small area, somehow or another you gain some of that authority and you feel comfortable asking for things. Of course Joanna and Eleanor would ask, Dad, can I help sing with you? Because, well, their dad's the singer, so they know they can ask. I'm not talking about, you know, kids being brats because their parents have some authority. That's different. I'm talking about kids trusting that their parent, their mother or their father, wants them to be a part of what they do. We are God's kids. We are co-heirs with Christ. We get to be a part of His work. And I think the way we begin to allow Him not just to be the center of our lives, but to show us what it looks like to live out of that center, is that we beg and we plead, be the center. And we trust that He's going to do it. Now, typically, something like this, I would ask Eric to sing a song that relates to it. But one of the problems with our worship gatherings, besides this win, is that I can't suddenly ask somebody to do something without like a week's advance. I mean, matter of fact, the videos that were a part of this, almost all of them were from 2 weeks ago. But if we were together and I could ask him to just sing something, I would ask him to sing this song called Be the Center, or Be the Century is how it's kind of spelled. Because it fits it. But I can't ask that, so we're out of luck, and you have to put up with me trying to sing it. I'm going to put the words up if you wanted to sing it with me. I'm going to look at the words because otherwise I will forget them. Jesus, be the center. Be my source. Be my light, Jesus. Jesus, be the center. Be my hope, be my song, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart. Be the wind in these sails. Be the reason that I live. Jesus, 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 be my vision. Be my path. Be my guide, Jesus. Be the fire in my heart. Be the wind in these sails. Be the reason that I live, Jesus, Jesus. Say, that song is such a simple request that is life-altering. Jesus, be the center. Be what everything before was leading to, and be what affects everything afterwards. This week, I pray that we each start our day off by asking that Jesus will be our center. And then we allow that to flow out as we see the world differently and we respond to the world differently. As we love justice and love mercy and walk humbly with God. Would you join me in our closing prayer? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Friends, when He's the center of your life, we have life. When other things are, there is destruction. May his life, the life of the Spirit, be the center of your life. Have a great week.
Hi, boys and girls. Today we're continuing to talk about Moses, but we're going to talk a little bit more about his sister Miriam and his brother Aaron, who we've mentioned before. We're now finished with the book of Exodus, and we're moving into the book of Numbers. This is the Bible book of Numbers, chapter 12. We're going to be talking about what happens when you might be jealous about something your brother and sister get to do that you don't get to do, and kind of how God feels about that when we're jealous and when we complain a lot. Moses had married a wife from Cush, which is a country that's today called Ethiopia. Moses' sister Miriam and his brother Aaron, the high priest, were not happy, and they began to mutter and complain about Moses. "Has the Lord spoken only through Moses?" they asked. "Hasn't he also spoken through us?" The Lord heard their complaining. Now Moses was a very humble man, more humble than anyone else living at that time. That means he wasn't braggy. The Lord said to Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, "Come out to the tent of meeting, all three of you." And that was that tent called the tabernacle that we talked about a few weeks ago. All three of them went to the tabernacle. Then the Lord came down in a pillar of cloud, which stood at the entrance to the tent. The Lord then called Aaron and Miriam to step forward. They obeyed. The Lord said, "I reveal myself to prophets in dreams and visions, but I speak face to face with Moses. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses?" The Lord was angry with them both. When the cloud lifted from above the tent, Miriam's skin was leprous. It was white as snow. So leprosy was a really bad skin disease that caused sores and scabs all over your skin. And that's what Miriam had. When Aaron saw that Miriam had a terrible skin disease, he pleaded with Moses, "Please don't hold this sin against us. Don't let Miriam have skin that looks half eaten away," because it was covered with scabs and sores. So Moses cried out to the Lord, "Please, God, heal her." The Lord replied, "Send her outside the camp for 6 days in disgrace. After that, she can be brought back." So Miriam was kicked outside of the camp for 7 days. She was kind of put in a timeout for a week. When she returned, her skin was clean and she was welcomed back into the camp and her family. So this story tells us that God doesn't like it when we're jealous. We're each given different jobs to do in our homes and in our families, and even different jobs we're given to do for God. And he doesn't want us to be jealous and to complain, but to serve him with a happy and willing heart. I hope you have a wonderful weekend. We don't have a craft with this one, and we haven't with the last few because they've either been too complicated or it's just hard to find a good craft to go with them. But that will be coming again soon. Have a great week, guys.